Have we taken things a bit too far with solar?
It was a normal day in Spain on April 28, but at 12:03 something started to go wrong.
Historic cross-border power outage.
And 30 minutes later, more than 50 million people were without power for almost a full day. Even Portugal was affected in one of the most unusual blackouts in modern history.
And people immediately started pointing fingers at a solar farm in Spain's south.
Solar has become a cheap, clean, and widely available alternative to fossil fuels. But it has a problem that makes it different to every other way of making electricity. And to fix it, we need to start paying a lot more attention to the thing that unlocks solar's full potential, our electricity grid. So what exactly makes solar different? Most other ways of generating electricity involve heating up water. Heating up iced tea would work as well, but it would smell gross. So let's use water. In the real world, you heat that water up by burning coal or gas.
And then the steam does something really helpful.
Slowly at first. But then...
Woo! Baheej is spinning, and now you can use that motion to spin a generator, and bang, you get electricity. Woo! Oi.
Just don't let it get too hot. In real life, the pressured steam moves huge turbines, which spin gigantic generators. And this is the basic principle that generates thousands of gigawatt hours of electricity from coal, nuclear, or gas power stations. Even with hydro and geothermal, there is always something spinning. And all these generators spin in sync, creating one common heartbeat for the entire grid. 50 Hertz in Europe. Think of it as the entire grid ticking 50 times per second. That's a sign all is going well. Electricity supply perfectly matches demand. All those power plants on one side and everything that uses electricity, like your washing machine, your fridge, coffee grinder or computer on the other are balanced.
If the demand suddenly disappears, the frequency goes up, which can literally fry the network. And then when the demand comes back or even spikes, the frequency can drop really quickly, and this can also cause a blackout.
But spinning turbines don't just help make electricity, they also keep the grid stable, because they have a naturally built-in security net called
inertia.
It means that the fidget spinner keeps going even after I stop pushing it.
The same goes for a huge turbine from a power plant, and this can come in handy when there is sudden turbulence on the grid.
The inertia basically buys time for a reaction from the rest of the power system.
This is Leonhard Gandhi, an energy system analyst at a German research institute.
And that is needed because there are, for example, many power plants which are used for so-called control energy, but they all need time to provide this extra energy.
The inertia that keeps those heavy turbines spinning buys them that time. It basically smooths out how fast the frequency drops or rises. And then there is solar.
No matter how close you look at this thing, there is nothing spinning to generate electricity.
And that means no inertia. That's why some commentators blamed solar for causing the blackout in Spain.
Everybody who follows energy closely and understands how electrical grids work knew that it was renewables.
And interestingly, it was triggered by too much sun.
They don't create that kind of system inertia.
Their argument is that because solar has no inertia, it can't help to stabilize the grid, making the heartbeat of 50 Hertz more fragile. The experts I've spoken with say all this talk about inertia is missing a crucial part about grid stability – voltage. Look at how it spiked before the blackout. Let's quickly understand what exactly voltage is. Imagine this hose being the electricity grid.
And our iced tea is the electricity we want to transport.
When I raise this glass, the water flows into the lower one because there is a difference in water pressure. Electricity behaves in a similar way. It flows from a point with high pressure to a point with lower pressure. And the difference in pressure that makes electricity flow is called voltage.
But if the pressure goes up and down rapidly, the flow becomes irregular and the entire system is unstable, ultimately leading to
a blackout. And this is what seems to have happened in Spain.
Millions of people across Spain and Portugal have been hit by massive power cuts.
A massive power outage.
Affecting millions of people there.
As I'm producing this report, the investigation into the cause of Spain's blackout is still ongoing. But there are some pretty strong indicators.
As you can see in this graph, everything went south at 12:33.
Electricity generation collapsed, but why? We've already looked at the spikes in voltage at 12:03. Remember, that's pressure going up and down rapidly in the system. It's not clear what triggered this. Probably not the solar plant in Spain's south, but the plant may have played another role in the blackout.
If the voltages close to that power plant were oscillating already, then the controls of that plant could have actually misfired.
This is Jose Daniel Lara, a research engineer in the US.
And it is not unreasonable to hypothesize that one of these power plants that is also super large just latched on and started injecting power. So they actually tried to mimic the grid.
To blend in, solar plants are often set to mirror what's happening on the grid. But in this case, this may have made the voltage spikes worse. Other power plants in the grid should have chipped in to help keep everything under control, but for whatever reason, they didn't. While this type of blackout is unusual, there are some obvious reasons why the Spanish grid was overwhelmed. Spain deployed solar very early and very fast. In 2023 and 2024, they added the second most solar capacity within the EU. But they forgot to add something else. Compared to other European countries, they only invested $0.3 into upgrading and stabilizing their grid for every dollar they put into renewables. The EU average is $0.7, more than double. And Spain's grid had another big problem. Some of the rules that govern which type of energy is allowed to bolster the grid are 10 or 25 years old. They effectively rule out solar from contributing to a more stable grid.
That probably would have solved, I don't want to sound too secure about this number, but like 80% of the problem could have been resolved.
I would have liked to talk to the Spanish Ministry of Ecological Transition about this, but they didn't get back to me. Luckily, there are solutions for Spain and other countries facing the same dilemma. The first one...
a giant fidget spinner named synchronous compensator.
These are essentially generators with giant spinning weights attached to them. This combo can regulate voltage and provide inertia in regions with lots of solar energy and where there aren't many spinning turbines.
In reality, you have in the grid always small disturbances.
This is German Kuhn. He's an expert in grid stabilizing mechanisms.
These small oscillations, the so-called small signal behavior in the system, is controlled or stabilized constantly by synchronous condenser.
Another solution is so-called static compensators, or STATCOMs. As you can see, they don't spin, but through an intricate system of switches, they can regulate voltage in the grid. Paired with modern algorithms and attached to a solar farm, they can make solar act like a spinning power plant that stabilizes the grid. Spain is planning to build these in the future, and they might be one of the best arguments against concerns about adding too many solar plants to the grid.
It cannot be too many, it can be too many uncontrolled. When it is coordinated and clearly invested across the country, where could be a good location, where can I compensate, and what controller types? I mean, this is controlled and regulated, and it cannot be too much.
Yes, solar doesn't spin, but is that a catastrophic and unsolvable problem for our grid? No, but everybody has to do their homework.
Countries need to upgrade their grids so that they're ready for more solar. Then we can keep rolling out this cheap, reliable, and clean source of electricity all over the world, and our grids can keep up.
Now, when someone comes at you saying renewables are bad for our grid, just send them this video. And if you want more stories like this, just go to dw.com.